بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Inshallah, in this short lecture directed towards the sisters residing in Britain, I'll begin discussing the issue of taqwa, about seeking knowledge, and about the increase of iman. I will begin by speaking about taqwa in order that we have an understanding of what taqwa is. Linguistically, taqwa is, as Hafidh Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, al-aslu taqwa atawqi mimma yakrahu li'anna aslaha waqa min al-wiqaya. He said, may Allah have mercy upon him, that taqwa, it is the foundation of it is to guard against that which Allah hates, or that which is disliked, because the origin of taqwa is the word wiqaya, shield or protection. And Islamically, or legislatively, the word taqwa has been described by Tariq ibn Habib, rahimahullah, one of the salaf of the ummah. He said, أن تعمل بطاعة الله على نور من الله ترجو ثواب من ثواب الله. The taqwa is to do the actions of obedience to Allah upon light from Allah, hoping for the reward of Allah. وأن نترك المعصية لله, and that we leave off the disobedience of Allah, على نور من الله تخاف عقاب الله, and that we leave off the disobedience of Allah upon light from Allah, fearing the punishment of Allah. And this narration has been reported by Imam Ibn Abi Shaybah in Kitab al-Iman, and great authentic by Shaykh al-Albani. In commenting upon this, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said that these phrases, this definition of taqwa, it combines between knowledge and action, hoping for the reward and fear of punishment. This is taqwa. And he mentioned that in his Risalah, Zad al-Da'iyah ilallah, page number 10. So taqwa is a very big topic, which I cannot cover in this short reminder. But we see from the definition of taqwa that it has to do with knowledge. As Tariqi said, rahimahullah, light from Allah, meaning knowledge. And likewise, staying away from the disobedience of Allah upon knowledge. And light itself is what the Qur'an has been described by. The Qur'an has been described as light. Allah, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بُرْهَانٌ مِّنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ نُورًا مُّبِينًا. O mankind, verily has come to you a convincing proof from your Lord, we have sent down to you manifest light. Surah An-Nisa, ayah 174. And the scholars of tafsir say that the word here, نُورًا مُّبِينًا, it means the Qur'an. So we see here, in order to have taqwa, we need to have knowledge of the Qur'an and the sunnah. And if someone has taqwa, then taqwa is from the greatest means to gain knowledge. Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, he said, rahmatullahi alayh, from the appointed means to seek knowledge are many. And we'll mention some of them. First, the taqwa is the recommendation of Allah for those before and those after from His servants. As Allah, He says, وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. And verily we have recommended to the people of the scripture before you, and to you the Muslims, that you fear Allah. And then he quotes the hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the hadith of Abu Umama, Suddi ibn Ajlan al-Bahili, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he said that he heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yakhtubu fil hajjit al-wada'a. He gave a lecture, a sermon in the hajjit al-wada'a, the farewell hajj, where he said, اتقوا ربكم, اتقوا الله ربكم, fear Allah or fear your Lord, وصلوا خمسكم, وصوموا شهركم وأدوا زكاة أموالكم وأطيعوا ذا أمركم تدخلوا جنة ربكم. Fear or have taqwa of your Lord. Pray your five prayers. Fast your month, means Ramadan. Pay the zakat on your wealth and obey those who are in charge of you and you will enter paradise of your Lord. And this hadith is in great authentic Imam al-Wadi'i in Sahih Musnad number 480. Then the Shaykh al-Uthaymeen continues and he talks about the benefits of taqwa in increasing the knowledge. And they go hand in hand. He says that Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تَتَّقُوا يَجْعَلْ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ فُرْقَانًا وَيُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيَّآتِكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ ذُو الْفَضْلِ الْعَظِيمِ. All you who believe, if you obey and fear Allah, He will grant you furqan, a criterion to judge between right and wrong. And He will expiate your sins and forgive you. And Allah is the owner of the great bounty. Surah Anfal, ayah 28:9. Ibn Uthaymeen, he comments, rahimahullah, saying this verse mentions three important benefits. The first is Allah will grant you a furqan, a criterion. And that is, He will grant you what will allow you to distinguish truth from falsehood, between harmful and beneficial. And this encourages, or this enters into knowledge, in terms of Allah opening for a person, from the sciences, what He does not open for others. For verily through taqwa, an increase in guidance is obtained, an increase in knowledge is attained, an increase in memorization is attained. And that's the point we're mentioning here. Through an increase in taqwa, or through taqwa, an increase in guidance is obtained, an increase in knowledge is obtained, and an increase in memorization. And this is what has been mentioned from Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, when he said, شَكَوْتُ إِلَى وَكِيعُ سُوْ حِفْظِي فَأَرَشَدَنِي إِلَى تَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي وَقَالِ اعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ الْعِلْمَ النُّورُ وَالنُّورَ اللَّهِ لَا يُؤْتَاهُ عَاصِي. Shafi'i said, may Allah have mercy upon him, I complained to Waqi' about my bad memory, so he directed me to leave off disobedience. And he said, know that the knowledge is light, and the light of Allah is not given to one who is disobedient. So no doubt every time a person increases in knowledge, he increases in his awareness, and the criterion between truth and falsehood, harmful and beneficial, become clear. Likewise, entering into this is what Allah opens up for a person of understanding. This is because taqwa is the cause for strengthening understanding. And a strengthening understanding leads to an increase in knowledge. So you see two men, both memorize a verse of Allah. Or then one of them is able to extract three rulings from that verse, whereas the other can extract more in accordance to what Allah has given him of understanding. So taqwa is a cause for the increase in understanding. And all this quote has been taken from the Shaykh's book, Kitab al-Ilm, page 44 and 45. So we see here for those who have taqwa, Allah increases them in knowledge. And we need to know, if you love to seek knowledge, or we want to increase in knowledge, then we likewise will have to have taqwa. Ibn Uthaymeen, in another place, he said, rahimahullah, that the point number 11, taqwa is a means to increase knowledge. And he quoted the verse of Allah, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمْ اللَّهُ. So be afraid of Allah, and Allah teaches you. Surah Baqarah, ayah 282. And this is from his work, Fawaidu Taqwa min al-Qur'an al-Kareem, page 13. So taqwa and knowledge, they go hand in hand. In fact, this is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to advise. And he used to admonish the women specifically to have taqwa. As it comes in the hadith of Jabir, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, قال ثم مال ومضى إلى النساء ومعه بلال فأمرهن بتقوى بتقوى الله ووعدهن وذكرهن وحمد وأثنى عليه ثم حسنهن على طاعته. Then Jabir said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he moved and went to the women. And Bilal was with him. And he commanded them to fear Allah. And he exhorted them and reminded them. He praised and glorified Allah. Then he urged them to obey Allah. And this wording is found in Sahih Sunan Nasa'i. And it has origin in Sahih Muslim. So likewise, I advise myself and you to fear Allah and have taqwa of Him. And that leads to the next topic, which is seeking knowledge and increasing iman. For a person has taqwa of Allah, he or she will increase in iman. And increase in knowledge is a means of increasing and fearing Allah. As it comes in the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا بَالَ أَقْوَامًا يَنْتَزِهُونَ عَنِ الشَّيْءِ أَصْنَعُهُ فَوَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَأَشَدُّهُمْ لَهُ خَشْيَةٌ. What is wrong with such people who are refraining from doing a thing that I do? By Allah, I know Allah better than they, and I'm more afraid of Him than they are. Bukhari, hadith number 6101. This hadith, it shows the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had more knowledge than the companions, and he has more taqwa. And coming on this, some of the scholars of hadith, they mentioned that the knowledge has been given precedence, or has preceded fearing Allah, because knowledge is what is the result to fear Allah. Means with knowledge, then you can fear Allah. As Allah, He says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Verily, those who fear Allah the most from His servants are those who are the scholars. Then, if someone were to increase his knowledge, he will be able to increase his iman. As Shaykh Abdul Razak ibn Abdul Muhsin al-Abbad al-Badr, he has a very good book called Asbab al-Ziyadat al-Iman wa al-Nuqsani, the means to increase the iman, or means of increasing and decrease of iman. And he says there the very first point, verily from the most important and beneficial means to increase the iman is to learn beneficial knowledge based upon the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he quotes many narrations about the excellence of seeking knowledge. Perhaps I will quote some of them, like the verse of Allah, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولُو الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Allah bear witnesses that there is no God worthy of worship except for He. And then the angels and those who have been given knowledge. So here in the verse, Allah has put the people of knowledge in high status. That they are those who bear witness to the truth after Allah and the angels. And Allah, He says, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُوا الْخَبِيرُ. Allah will exalt in degrees those who fear Allah, those who believe in Allah, and those who have been granted in knowledge. And Allah is well acquainted with what you do. And then there is a hadith, the hadith of Abi Umama al-Bahili radiallahu ta'ala anhu, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were mentioned to him two men. One of them was a worshipper, and the other one was a scholar. And the Messenger said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَضْلُ الْعَالِمْ عَلَى الْعَابِدْ كَفَضْلِي عَلَى أَدْنَاكُمْ. The excellence of a scholar over a servant is like the excellence of me over the lowest amongst you. And then he continued by saying, indeed Allah and His angels and the inhabitants of the heavens and earth, even the ant in its hole, even the fish, they send blessings upon the one who teaches the people good. And the hadith has been greater authentic by Shaykh al-Albani, Sahih al-Tirmidhi. Then Shaykh Abdul Razak, he mentioned a great point here. Because some of us may say, I seek knowledge, but I don't see the increase in iman. And that is the issue. When we increase the knowledge, we should increase in iman. He quotes a statement, Imam Ibn Qayyim, he said, rahimahullah, وَكُلُّ عِلْمٍ وَعَمَلٍ لَا يَزِيدُ الْإِيمَانَ وَقُوَّةَ فَمَدْخُولٍ. Every knowledge and action that does not increase the iman and strengthen it, then it's diseased. Every knowledge and action that does not increase the iman and strengthen it, then it is diseased. And this narration, and the Shaykh mentions in the book, and this all has been taken from the page 13 of this book, and you can find this book available in print and online in English. So we see here that the person who has taqwa, that will lead them to increase in knowledge. And an increase in knowledge will lead to an increase in iman. And it's specifically important for the sisters to seek knowledge by attending beneficial classes taught by the Salafi brothers and sisters. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to give a day and teach the women. As it comes in the hadith Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. جاء امرأة إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت يا رسول الله ذهب الرجال بحديثك. A woman came to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, O Messenger of Allah, only men can benefit from your talk. So please fix for us a day so you can teach us that which Allah has taught you. So the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم fixed it for them a day which they gathered and he taught them Hadith Bukhari. So if it's important for the women that they have classes, and that they should also benefit from these classes. If it's a class taught by men, then behind the veil. And if it's not, then they can benefit from that which is of the recorded lessons, or live lessons like we are doing now. Or that they find a female teacher who can teach them in the house, from the different sciences of the religion. And if that is available. And if she cannot find that, then she continues to study on her own at home, reading from the beneficial books, and reading the Qur'an and Sunnah. As Allah, He says, وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُطْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ لَطِيفًا خَبِيرًا. And remember, O family of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that which is recited in your houses of the verses of Allah and the hikmah, i.e. the sunnah, verily Allah is, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-latif al-khabir. Surah Ahzab, ayah 34. So here we see Allah is addressing the mothers of the believers to recite and to learn and to study and review and ponder upon the Qur'an and sunnah in their houses. And I will finish by this mentioning, by reading beneficial books, the woman can increase her knowledge and benefit a lot. A celibate sister should organize a schedule for herself, by which she can benefit. Shaykh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i, rahimahullah, was asked the following question. Is it possible for you, O our Shaykh, may Allah reward you, to advise us, for us, a program and stages of learning which a sister can apply in her home until she reaches a high level of knowledge? Shaykh Muqbil said, rahimahullah, that which I advise with is gradual progression of knowledge, reading easy books. For verily, it will grant her understanding of many books. Examples are Riyadu Salihin, Fathu al-Majid, Sharh Kitab al-Tawheed, Ulugh al-Maram, al-Hafidh ibn Hajar. And this is if she can understand this. If she cannot understand this, then there are small books. I know, for example, he mentioned our brother Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahab al-Wasabi, his book Qawl al-Mufid. And I mentioned here that this Shaykh praised Wasabi before. I had some criticism have come his way. So the book he's referring to is Qawl al-Mufid fi Adillat al-Tawheed. And it's an easy book. Likewise, he says, is it possible she can read the Sunnah of Ibn Abi Asim, or the Sunnah of Muhammad ibn Nasir al-Marwazi, or the Sunnah of Abdullah ibn Ahmed like this? What is important is, it is necessary she organizes her time, and not increasing lessons which she takes, for perhaps she will not digest them. And the Shaykh continues to say, as I advise you to connect with the virtuous scholars, if anything is difficult for you, likewise writing benefits. If it is easy for a woman and her husband to travel to the centers of knowledge in Yemen, then I advise that, Wallahu musta'an. And this was taken from the book As'ila Yasim in France, and is quoted in the book Al-Ajubatul Wadi'iyya ala As'ilatul Nisa'iyya, page 22 and 23. And inshallah, we'll stop the short reminder about that. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.